CFLP has a similar and a parallel version for session for the import and export logistics. So we started year from year in 2007. It means that we are very interested in the import and export logistics, and that represents the direction of our future. So for today's conference, three sessions altogether for our track. In the first session, we're going to give you a brief account of the general situation. Secondly, we're going to focus on Belt and Road Initiative and the spare parts and components import and export business. The third part is the OEM interaction. The first session will have about three speakers and the guests. The first guest is Mr. Wu Songquan, Director of Auto Industry Policy Research Section of China Automotive Technology and Research Center. Welcome. The second expert is Madam Hu Siyu, independent consultant of Ex-Sinomach Automobile. Also, the third one is the vice chairman of our association, Vice President Chen Gang of Changjiu Logistics, who is still on his way here due to the traffic jam. So I know this is the result of the high speed growth of the automotive industry, so we have to face the challenges of the explosion of this sector. Probably not every you are really optimistic about what happened since year 2015, and especially in the export we have the negative growth, but in 2016 there has been an upsurge of the momentum. For import, there has been no big changes compared with the domestic sales. This tends to be not a session where we see really rapid and a lot of changes, but ever since last year we have seen really something quite encouraging and quite constructive, like Anji Logistics, who has been busy serving the rural business in Philippines and also in North America, and they have been serving as the very useful operator in between for the rural business to provide the relevant solutions. So this is a good sign. We are really shifting towards a new direction, and the general manufacturing facility of the automotive industry is really getting on to a new height. So last year, Mr. Cao Dewang has made its investment in North America. You know, Mr. Cao is the chairman of Fuyao Glass Company Limited. And for us, for our business, I think this is a very necessary step for us to go international for the automotive industry. So very early on, before the information comes out, there has been a lot of information about the possibility for the deployment overseas of the relevant sectors. So these are some of the new changes we have to understand and be ready to embrace. So first, let's invite Mr. Wu Songquan from CATRC to give us a brief account. Thank you, and welcome. So morning everyone, and it's my great pleasure to attend the Automotive Logistics Conference for more time. I attended many times, and each time I was here, I am responsible for the introduction of some relevant policies for the import and export of autos. actually, there have been no big changes of the policies, but I want to use this opportunity to share with you some of the latest policies that will have an impact on the future of the industry. There are two parts of my presentation. First of all is export, second one is import. Talking about the export of cars, well, the central government puts a lot of attention on its policies, with a lot of relevant policies and the regulations covering the research and the development support, the overseas investment, financing services, the standardization issues, and so on and so forth. Later, Madam Hu Siyu will have another separate presentation about the import and export of cars, so I will be quite brief on this part. This is the export volume of cars since year 2002. Last year, the figure is about 700,000. Probably some unnecessary factors have been already deducted from this chart. So the pure figure is around 700,000, which is exactly the same figure as year 2015. However, it is still a big drop compared with our historical high being 1 million sets. This is the components export. Last year, 6 million. This is a big number in the world. So that means China is already one of the biggest exporters of spare parts and components. Talking about the export, we have a few status quo. The drop or the decrease margin begins to shrink a little bit. There has been some rapid reductions over the past few years. And for some traditional markets, the business is not so good, to the only exception of some countries and regions relevant to the Belt and Road Initiative. And here you can see that the export to America, to Egypt, to Russia increased substantially. The third characteristic is that some local brands become the mainstay, and also some joint venture companies are also looking for some opportunities of expanding towards the overseas market. In the past, due to some multinational companies' regulations, there has been no big increase, but ever since last year, you can see huge increase, like Cherry and Shanghai Autos, Shanghai Automotive Company Limited, SAIC. So you can see from this chart, it's quite clear. We have the figures for both the Shanghai Automotive GM being number one, accounting for about 16.7% of the total, and the export volume is over 80,000. And for Honda China, it's ranking number two, 11,000 sets, accounting for 2.42%, followed by Citroen and Dongfeng and Nissan and Brilliance BMW. And the fourth feature is that there has been some slight reduction of the export of spare parts for autos. Mainly, I mean the export for the developed countries. Last year, the total volume of export for spare parts is about 6.4573 million US dollars, down by 2.8% compared with the same period last year. And America is still the biggest export market, accounting for 26% of the total. You know, China is facing a lot of complexities, especially related to the international trading environment. First of all, there has been a slack power for the recovery of the world economic growth. Secondly, the so-called anti-globalization is on the increase, impeding the growth of globalization as a process. And also the trade scenario is undergoing profound and far-reaching transformations, and the global value chain is ushered into a period of restructuring. Looking ahead into the future, you can see that there will be some ever deterioration of the international environment for trade investment. And some big heads will continue to hold most of the power, and some joint venture companies are also focusing more on the international market, for example, to launch more products in the overseas regions. The foreign capital is also involved into the operation of some joint venture companies, both in China and in the rest of the world. So we can have every reason to believe that China will become one of the key centers or the basis for the export of cars for most of the developed nations and markets in the world. Talking about the complexities of the international trade environment, we cannot forget about the new regime taking into office in America, and also in the new policies are coming out. Also, I have to mention that the traditional comparative advantages of the export industry continues to weaken, apparently. However, the comprehensive advantages of the industries will be maintained for a long time. Number four, some countries are facing turbulent situation of their politics, increasing the difficulties for the restrictions over the expanding of the trade volume. The number five, the reason for the trade in the future is the unsophisticated financial systems rendering difficulties for financing overseas. So I will skip the following few details, but talking about the status quo of the export policies, we have done a lot, and these are some of the policies we launch out for the purpose of standardizing the whole industry, including the decrees and the regulations coming from the Ministry of Commerce, the State Council, and also ever since the 18th Party's Congress, the party has put forward the slogan to construct an open-ended economy to comprehensively increase the level of internationalization for the auto industry. The purpose of doing so is to mobilize all the resources of the whole world to our home benefit. Talking about the fourth one, which is about the policy prospectus. Enough has been talked about the policies, including the export rebates, the standardization of the export practices, and so on and so forth, in addition to the financial and the subsidy. So I will skip this part. But talking about the future, I have to mention one key document, which is the master plan for the 13th five-year period, especially for the development of the foreign trade, pointing out the future directions for the growth of the export industry. Secondly, I want to mention a little bit about FTA. So for so many policies at play, FTA tends to be a factor that we cannot ignore, and this is also one of the key links out of the whole chain. You know, we have already signed around 15 FTA agreements covering 22 countries and regions, and so far around 9 FTA agreements are ongoing, including RCEP and other negotiation mechanisms. The core of RCEP is to break down the barriers of bilateral trades and the multilateral trades between different countries, and to facilitate the international trade. RCEP 10 plus 6, including India and many other countries along the Belt and Road line, and also it includes the Japan and also South Korea. So for all these above mentioned few countries, they are also facing some difficulties, including Japan. There has been also a lot of attention manifested towards the auto industry. The manifestation is quite apparent, not only for Japan but also from India. And so as a result of the negotiations and also the signing of so many agreements, I think things will be better in the future. Belt and Road Initiative tends to be a big system arrangement that we cannot avoid, and also we have to capitalize upon. So I think that all the relevant countries and regions along the road and the belt can be well involved into the whole initiative to really give full play to our advantages of economic development and to serve as a great complement to China's economy. Of course, we have a lot of challenges and difficulties, I have mentioned some of the difficulties. You know, the meeting between President Xi and Donald Trump has just concluded. I don't know whether these talks will be touching upon autos, but anyway, I think that you can shift your eyes towards the China-US trade relations, including the tariff and non-tariff regulations, whether the investment policies can be further optimized or not. So this will be a point of attention in the future. Talking about future in EU, I think that the Brexit is a key factor. This will impact the strategies of our business, especially the Chinese domestic companies' expansion business in Europe. You know, as a result of the Brexit, you know, still there are some possibilities of renegotiating the so-called zero tariff preferential policies for the relevant holders. So whether or not it is necessary to recover the past practice, it is open to everybody's guess. And also some other flexibilities or some other possibilities may include the renegotiations over the issues like a trade preferential policies between China and the UK and China and the EU respectively. So this is the first part. The second part is the import. I've listed a few slides here. Still the same pattern. This is the import volume and the penetration rate and market share from year 2001 to 2016. You can see that the trend is on the decline, accounting for only about 3.8% in year 2016. This is the sedan car import volume. Last year, the market share is only 3.1%. Very low figure. Because, you know, the import cars are becoming even more high-end, more premium, more luxury, so the market share is getting smaller. So these are some of the specific data and figures, so I will skip this part, for petrol version, for diesel version, for sedans, and for many different type of displacements. And also we have some special purpose vehicles, SPVs, for most of the sedan cars and the passenger cars, over 90% of the market share has been gained. So for the import volume, these are some of the sources of the imports. Ranking number one to number three, we have Japan, America, and Germany. For passenger cars, we import cars mainly from Japan, America, and Japan, followed by India, followed by UK. So we import around 285,000 cars in year 2016 from Japan and 250,000 cars from North America and 224,000 cars from Germany. So these are some of the importers. Ranking number one to number five is BMW, Mercedes-Benz, Toyota, Porsche, and Jaguar Land Rover. This is the policy system for the import cars. I think you are familiar with this chart. You know, we have some organizations taking different responsibilities for the import permit, authorization, market access, customer clearance, and port management, respectively governed by Ministry of Commerce, the quarantine and Quality Inspection Bureau, the Ministry of Environmental Protection, the Department of Transportation is also one part of it, because it carries its responsibilities mainly in the oil consumption management for all operating cars. All the oil consumption have to be in line with the Chinese regulations. So that's why this department is also important for the authorization. For customer clearance and port management, of course, it's governed by the General Administration of Chinese Customs. For the taxation policies, of course, it is governed not only by the Ministry of Finance, but also by the Customs Clearance, by the Customs Office. The sales and market supervision is governed by the Ministry of Commerce, NDRC, the General Administration of Industry and Commerce. For registration, Ministry of Public Security carries its duties. For product responsibilities, of course, the Quality Inspection Bureau and the Environmental Protection Bureau are the two organizations governing this affairs. For the maintenance, it's governed by the Ministry of Department of Transportation. And for the recycling and end of vehicles remanufacturing, it's governed not only by the MII, Ministry of Information Industry and DRC, but also by Ministry of Commerce. This is the import tax policies in detail.
Well, FTA is resulting in the changes in the tariff. For example, the FTA between China and South Korea, once came into effect, and we only charge 22.5% of the import tariffs on the Korean imported vehicles. There's another kind of import tariff that is related to the, what we called the import tax itself. The consumption, the policy on the consumption tax changed last year. On this slide, I can see the continuous changes to the consumption policies or consumption tax policies over the past couple of years, starting from December the 1st. If the retail price of the luxury, if the retail price exceeds 1.3 million RMB yuan, at the retail market, 10% of the consumption tax will be imposed. Tax is payable by the forest center or whoever sells the vehicles to the end customers. So the tax is levied on the retail market. Well, let's say if the vehicle is worth of 1.3 million without the VAT, net of VAT, so they will add 130,000 RMB as a consumption tax. So the aggregated tax burden is about 170,000 on a vehicle worth of 1.3 million. So apparently, someone has to bear the brunt of that extra 170,000 yuan. Another important policy is the vehicle sales policy. There are two documents. One is the automotive sales management method. Well, in a couple of days, the Ministry of Commerce is going to launch a press conference to release the new automotive sales management method. The purpose of the original method is to break the monopoly on the sales of the vehicles to provide better protections on the consumers. Probably very soon, Mr. Hu will give you a presentation on that specific point. And the NDRC also issued a document called the anti-price cartel in the auto sales. So this document will have a direct impact upon the relationship between the dealers and the OEM. I think eventually it is the customers that will become the beneficiary to these documents. The third policy I'm going to talk about is the parallel import. The parallel import is in operation in some free trade zones in China, and the State Council also issued a couple of opinions, regulations, and documents on promoting the parallel import. So a lot of these documents facilitated the expansion of the parallel import. I'm not going to details. Mr. Hu will give you a more detailed introduction. So far, the parallel import volume is about 130,000. While the imported vehicle volume is going down, the parallel import vehicles volume is going up. Another policy that is related to the imported vehicle is the average fuel consumption. There is a very strict regulations on the fuel efficiency. Last year, the industrial average it is 6.98 liters per 100 kilometers, and that standards will continue to rise in the future, which poses a very, very heavy pressure on both the domestic vehicles as well as the imported vehicles. I urge you to pay attention to this slide. This is the statistics collected in 2016 by the Ministry of Industrial Information. Well, this is all about the fuel efficiency by different brands. The colored OEMs represent the OEMs that fail to meet the fuel efficiency standards, including Ford, Jaguar Land Rover, Mitsubishi, Nissan. Probably in the future, there will be more and more OEMs that fail to meet this fuel consumption or fuel efficiency standards because of the tightening standards. There might be some penalty measures issued by the NDRC. Well, another related policy is the NEV quota management. In this regard, there were two types of policies. First type of policy is related to the green emission or the reduction of emission or the emission of greenhouse gas, and the other type of policies is related to the use of new energy. The MII itself has already issued a couple of a series of policies in promoting the use of new energy vehicles. I think all the imported vehicles are facing heavy pressures. The Policy Research Center is a core department of the China Automobile Technology Research Center. And the research area will include industrial policies, development strategies, and planning, and fiscal budget, and tax policies. That concludes my presentation. Thank you very much. Well, thank you, Mr. Wu, for your wonderful presentation. I think you gave us a lot of content in your presentation. So because of the time limitation, I understand you have to skip some parts. We'll have a Q&A session. So during the Q&A sessions, you can exhaust or you can raise the questions of your personal interest. Mr. Wu gave us some interpretations on the new policies on the imported vehicles. Our next speaker will be an expert in this industry. He's Madam Hu Siyu. He used to be a Sinomach Automobile employee. Now he's an independent consultant. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Well, I really appreciate it of the organizing committee for giving me this opportunity. Well, the organizer gave me a very big topic. I have to cover import and export. I have to cover the whole vehicle and spare parts. So probably, if you want me to exhaust this topic, you have to give me a whole day. The China Import and Export, Vehicle Import and Export Corporation has been in the business for 24 years, and I've been in this company for more than a decade, so I think I have a fairly good understanding of the import and export, vehicle import and export market, and I have a fairly good understanding and observations on the future trend of the import and export market, especially on the parallel import. I'm going to share with you some of the statistics in the import and export market. Well, this is a grand topic. So I'm going to give you a review of the vehicle import and export. I'll help you to understand the import vehicle and its position in the Chinese vehicle market. And also, I'm going to tell you some of my forecast on the on different market segments from now till the end of 2020. When we start to approach the market, we try to understand the demand. For example, what kind of audience or customers, what kind of vehicles that a certain audience or certain customers will buy. And also, we can approach the market from the supply side, the volume of the supply, the portfolio, the structure of the supply. So first of all, let's take a look at the positioning of the import and export vehicle import and export market. So quantitatively, the vehicle import and export volume can reach 1 million or 2 million, but number does not speak for itself. Well, here I'm focused only on the whole vehicle import and export market. So this market positioning in China is pretty clear. I've been in this import vehicle market for more than 10 years. We understand that this import market is a helpful supplement to the domestic market. The complementary, well, the domestic market as well as the imported vehicle market, they're complementary to each other. Well, last year, the total sales volume, vehicle sales volume was 28 million. And the total import and export vehicle volume was only 2 million. But if you take a look at the transaction value, they accounted for close to 15 to 20% of the total transaction value in the automobile market. So import and export market or import and export business is a helpful supplement to the domestic vehicle market. China is not a automobile. It's not a strong manufacturer of automobiles. So if we can continue to export vehicles to international market, that speaks for the improvement of the quality of the domestic manufacturing capability. Well, 30 years ago, when the domestic car manufacturers signed the joint venture contract with the international car manufacturers, the vehicles manufactured by the joint ventures were not allowed to be exported. But right now, things have changed. So the market positioning of the import and export vehicle market is that it's a helpful supplement to the domestic market. Automobile industry is a pillar industry in the Chinese economy. Well, import and export market will become an indispensable market to the domestic vehicle market. Last year, the GDP was in China was 77 trillion, and the vehicle market size was about 4.4 trillion, accounts for 5% of the total GDP in China. During the implementation of the 13th Five-Year Plan, the state councils will pay critical attention to the vehicle or automobile market. So when the automobile market is not performing very well, the national government as well as the provincial government will issue different kinds of policies to stimulate the growth of the automobile market in China. In 2015, for the first three quarters in 2015, the automobile market was not performing very well. So without the stimulus policies, I think the sales volume in 2015 will register a negative growth. So in Q4 2015, the government launched a tax exemption policies for the vehicles with the engine displacement less than 1.6 liters. So it's easy to understand that the automobile industry is an important part of the Chinese economy, and the import and export business is a helpful or is a useful supplement to the domestic vehicle market. Now we need to take a look at some of the changes in the import and export market and what should the market player do to cope with these changes. On this slide you can see there are four graphs including the import, export and the import of whole vehicles, export of whole vehicles, import of parts and export of parts. So you can take a look at the general trend. They represent different statistics, different numbers, but the general trend are the same. In 2012, they're positively correlated to the GDP growth in China. In 2012, the GDP growth rate started to slide down below 8%. Before 2012, the GDP annual growth GDP growth rate was above 8%, but after 2012, the GDP growth rate started to slow down and the world economy was not in a very good shape. So between 2011 to 2014, well, the import and export business was still fairly good, but starting from 2014, the import and export business start to come down very rapidly. In some niche market, or a specific segment of the market, and thanks to the national stimulus policies, there might be some positive growth, but generally speaking, the market size and the general business sentimental is going down because of the slowing down of the GDP growth rate. As Mr. Wu said, that there are so many policies playing in this automobile market. But if you're running a business, we have to be very careful with these policies. So how do these policies influence the business performance? Well, the import and export market is closely or positively correlated to the economic fundamentals. Well, this year the GDP growth rate will be probably around 6.5%. So for the first time in the national report submitted to the National People's Congress, the government said that the GDP growth rate will be around 6.5, instead of saying that the GDP growth rate will be 6.5%. So meaning the government is not 100% confident that the GDP growth rate will be 6.5%. So the economic recovery is still pretty slow, and the import and export business is not will not be in a very good shape. But the One Belt, One Road initiatives will have some positive effect on the import and export market. But as to the quantitative influence from the One Belt, One Road initiatives, there's no conclusive numbers to be cited. I'm more on the import market. If you take a look at the policy environment, there are positive policies for import market, but these policies are not going to have a very strong play in the imported market. The tax exemption policy will be phased out gradually. Well, this policy was launched in October 2015, and in the next 15 months following the launch of that stimulus policies, there was a mild increase in the imported volume. But as the policy is about to gradually phase out, I don't think it's going to further drag the import volume.
Parallel import is another issue that you are very interested in, and you know that tomorrow the auto sales regulation will take on a new name. So you know, around 14 months has been ahead of the final revision is made to the name for the parallel imports. A description is that the current policies and regulations will be served as a very important reference. So the starting point, of course, is the approvement or the approval of the regulations or the comments for the support of the free trade zone in Shanghai. And over the past few months, you can see that indeed the parallel import volume is increasing, especially since last year, despite the minus growth of import cars, but still parallel imports increased by a double-digit growth. Last year, the total volume imported is around 230,000, but this year I think that the figure will be around 150,000. This will be a strong boost for the future volume increase. For parallel imports, as I said, the total market share is somewhere around 130,000 to 150,000. So in the future, probably the market will not be changed too much from the original scenario. For the product supply, as the consumers, the original import cars have been localized. Originally, you want to buy ABB, but to the only exception of a D-class or SUV, almost all other segments, like low-end, medium-sized, or B-level below cars, are all localized or manufactured locally. So since year 2014, this represents the starting point. Many of the products, especially the volume cars, have been well localized. The import cars, in terms of the supply volume, I think it's on the decline, that's for sure. It is not a bad thing, but for the importers, especially for companies related to imports, this is deemed as something not so good. So here I've listed so much of the product supply, but still, I don't think in terms of the content, the supply is not supposed to be something that we can increase too much. For parallel imports, still, I think many people tend to demonize parallel imports. In addition to the car industry and other markets, probably you all face the parallel import issues. Many people will still use the capital to earn the market share. I think that probably somebody has been talking too much about apparel imports. This is by no means the biggest market. As I said, the total number is somewhere around 130,000 to 150,000. There are many governmental restrictions over the development of the apparel imports. It's not because of the rigid demand on the decline. According to our research, actually the demand is increasing, including the generation shift, including the grassroots or the mass public appeal. I think that all this import, especially apparel imports, will cater to a certain segment. For a company that imports around 50,000 cars every year, they will have to undertake the policy of the so-called new energy points or the credit points. Many people do not know too much about this policy, and they do not know what are some of the hidden dangers or the hazards behind such a policy. So everybody wants to have a try. If you do not know too much about the market conditions or the market requirement, so if you are totally obsessed with making or baking a bigger cake, I don't think it will lead you to a good result. So there could be many regulatory risks that you will face. So what we can wish is a very good environment for the development of the parallel import industry. So we don't lack the supply volume, but what we really lack seriously is the after sales market and the maintenance issues. Well, I think that if you want to learn more about the parallel imports, especially the figures, the numbers, please do come to me. I have only a few minutes left, so I will continue. I myself have been working on numbers and figures, so I will have a following few slides devoted to the figures. So by 2020, actually the import volume will be shrinking, this is for sure. On one hand, we have the market expectation, on the other hand, we have the policy restrictions. I remember, you can take a look at the chart on the left. The total volume of imports to China last year is about 1 million sets. And in the future, by 2020, the figure will be somewhere around 900,000. For the products that can be imported to China, of course, it has to abide by the policies and regulations. Some keywords including small displacement, small and compact cars, plug-in hybrids, diesel versions, oil consumption requirements should be all met in compliance with the industrial orientations, and also some new pure electric vehicles or the new energy vehicles should be the future. And in the short term, we have the PHEV products, and in the medium and the long term, we are going to introduce more pure electric products. For the consumption trend, I think there will be three directions for the future demand for the cars for China's import. First of all, high-end, the consumers will display more consumption behaviors to highlight their own status and their own achievements. So the original Passat or A-Cord B-Class car consumers will choose to upgrade their consumption level. Secondly, personalization, they will choose to display their own individual characteristics and many people will give up the big cars but choose to buy some small but cute premium cars or some import personalized car like coupes or MPVs. And also The third key feature is the new energy cars that will also be well related to the personal consumption or the demand of consumption. For parallel import demand, as I said, the market share will be a little bit down. This year, the peak will be somewhere around the 17%, but by 2020, still, the figure will be maintained at about 12%. That's about 150,000 per year. For export, Mr. Hu has talked a lot about that. I don't have much time, so still, my comment is the same as his. The export reduction is largely because of the generic economic performance and the trade barriers and the non-tariff barriers, so our future opportunities will be the Road and the Belt Initiative. And we talked about something about why the local brands are really having a lot of say in the future. So I fully agree with this point. In general, this year the total volume will be quite stable. I think that you can take my PowerPoint presentation later after the speech. You can take a look at all those figures, but generally speaking, our forecast is that the export volume of 2017 is the same as year 2016. I won't talk too much about the structure, the model mix, the same as our previous statement. For spare parts and components, before I conclude, from the general volumes perspective from 2011 to 2016, the export volume of car spare parts is on the decline. There has been a big difference between the imports and exports. We import less, but export more. The total import volume is somewhere around the $20 billion, whereas the export is somewhere around the $60 billion. That's about three times that of the import. The same scenario this year. There will be no big changes. So that basically concludes my presentation. Different figures and different numbers. Well, if you want to have the numbers, you can come to me later. Thank you. Well, indeed, we have a lot to say, and the speaker has prepared too much to say, because you can see there are many pages of her presentation, but still we don't have much time to go through all these ones. If time permitting, we can leave some time for some Q&A. So now let's invite the third speaker to catch up with the time, Mr. Chen Gang from Changjiu, a logistics company, to give us a presentation. The topic of his presentation is the way to global by China Automotive Logistics. So, morning everyone. There are many familiar faces. My name is Chen Gang. In Changjiu, and I serve as the Vice President. And we have a lot of business, and Changjiu Logistics is mainly responsible for the international sector. Ever since last year, about one third of my time every year. Is abroad. Actually, I came back from UK yesterday, so I want to share with you some of my expertise. So while Mr. Bo is making a presentation, he has already talked about this part. Changjiu Logistics was founded in 1992. 2003, the headquarters has been moved to Beijing, and we began to follow the role of internationalization. and we win the bid of the Beijing Olympics torch relay. At that time, the Belt and Road Initiative was not initiated. We're the first to use the railway to transport components. And also we got the bid for the Audi International Railway Transportation, and in Hamburg of Germany we set up our own plant. So every year the total throughput is around 6 to 8 million containers. At that time, our office in Hamburg can seat around 45 people. In year 2016, we got listed in Asia Market in Shanghai. This has become the first company listed for the auto logistics. Ever since 2017, we began international purchasing and acquisition in Europe and America. This is the structure and the business portfolio. We have a Changjiu International Logistics, having German company, Japanese, US, UK office, HK office, taking responsibility of the international logistics. Hao Logistics Company, is mainly responsible for Harbin, Manzhouli, and Duisburg line. So the focus is on railway transport. Changjiu Logistics is mainly focusing on roadway transport for vehicles. And also we have another subsection called CDC International Logistics Company Limited. We have around 4 subsessions, like King 4, CDC, Schneider Logistics, and China Forever Logistics, and Yeming Technology. For Schneider is the biggest one in Germany, providing 29 plants for ABB and Porsche in Germany. So they did exactly one same thing over the past 5 decades. So this is the so-called past logistics governed by the Schlecker Logistics of CDC. China Forever Logistics is mainly responsible for returnable packaging logistics. It was founded about 2 years ago. Currently, their clients include Mazda and Jaguar Land Rover. From packaging and operation, they provide holistic services. Currently, they have been listed in Asia market. Yeming Technology Company is an IT company. Their focus is on the smart IT connections. So they have their own hardware, including their own self-governed facilities and the RFID expertise. So all this is related to international logistics. International logistics, international railway, recyclable packaging, and IT. Talking about our international services, mainly 4 parts. First of all, KD packing services. Secondly, China, Russia-Europe railways. Thirdly, domestic, global, returnable, recyclable packaging. The fourth one is Automotive Logistics Center in Europe. KD Packaging Service. Just now Mr. Hu mentioned. In the past, it's mainly undertaken by Cherry. They have around 900 employees covering around 60,000 square meters of floorage. We provide different services to Cherry, like packaging, like logistics appliances, like auxiliary sellings and household appliances. And also we have another sector focusing on the engineering machineries and the facilities. The international plastics, international logistics platform include the logistics transportation, on-site planning, packaging production, ocean-going transportation, and overseas services. And for each of the sector, we have the spare part component transportation, reshuffling, picking up of the commodities, 3PL management, So we operate our businesses for Chery, Fortune, Jaguar Land Rover, and many other brands. Our team has around 900 people. In the future, these are some of the key ports we are going to focus in Dalian, Tianjin, Chongqing, Guangzhou, and Shanghai. Unlike the traditional practice, which is really time-consuming, and our intention is to serve more brands and to deliver more streamlined services to get more spare parts and components from the OEMs, and this can also enhance the efficiencies.
So maybe we can reduce the logistic cost. According to our forecast, we're going to reduce the logistic cost by 15%. So our packaging team will be able to aggregate all the spare parts. At the export port, we got 150 people as a task force. So they can serve a certain spike or surge in the demand. So when there is a demand from Chery, will be able to earmark at least 30 to 40 employees to take over a sudden emergence of a business, and so that we can handle the packaging for 100 to 200 vehicles every day. I got 26 engineers who are specialized in the packaging of whole vehicles. But Chery's been doing the packaging vehicles for the export for quite a number of years. So the maximum production volume is 120,000 packagings every year. So they got a quite full-fledged infrastructures for the packaging of vehicles for export. But this is a quite sophisticated operating systems with quality assurance. The co-sharing of the purchase of materials is very important because the Chinese branded vehicles can't sell at a very high price in overseas market, and therefore the containment of the material purchase cost is of crucial importance. Well, since we can package 120,000 vehicles every year, we can assume a certain scale of economy. Well, this is an example of Chery. So we provide planning and design, packaging material, manufacturing and sourcing services. So our operating area is about 60,000 square meters with 900 full-time employees. We have our own proprietary IT systems. Well, the export packaging is a quite fluctuating business, and we have a way to even out the demand. This is the example in Iran. We provide an export vehicle packaging, and we also provide transportation of the vehicles. And we can also provide sea transportation of vehicles and the local truck transportation at the destination port. So we provide a holistic solutions to OEM. We have cooperation with Chery in China as well as in Iran. And we have other spare parts business partners. One of our clients has a total of 6,000 employees that provides an export services for BMW, for Mercedes-Benz, for Audi. So we partnered to establish a CSL company, which is a joint venture. So So we do both the domestic market as well as the international market, and we can provide seamless integrations between the domestic market and the international market. Well, our service outlet is in Iran, it's in Europe, back in China. So this is our second, I'm going to talk a little bit about the China-Europe railway. And I'm talking about the China-Europe railway from Harbin to Europe via Russia. So one of the important destinations is in Russia, and Changjiu Logistics has 59% of the shares, and Harbin Railway Stations has 23% of the total equity. So this is the route of the railway connecting Harbin to Europe. It is it sends 7 trains every week, so we got a daily train carrying cargoes from China to Europe. It carries timber, electronics, and other light industry products. We just won a bid from Volvo recently. A Volvo manufactured S90 in the city of Daqing, and Daqing is the only manufacturing site for the manufacturing of the highest quality Volvo vehicles. 2/3 of the vehicles are for export, and a large percentage of these exported vehicles go to Europe. So we successfully won the contract from Volvo. So we transport the vehicles from Daqing to a city in Belgium next to the English Channel. Right next to the west shore of English Channel. And we also provide services for Audi to transport the spare parts from China to Europe. And we also won a contract from Jaguar Land Rover. And we help Jaguar Land Rover to transport vehicles from Europe to China. Lear is also one of our clients. Well, currently, the outbound cargo outnumber the inbound cargo for China, but in automobile industry, the inbound cargo outvolumes the outbound volume. Well, every year China exports 10,000 vehicles to European markets, and we're lucky to be able to win that contract. Well, in the future, we're going to set up 4 China-Europe railway. The first line is from China to Poland. The second line is from China to Zeebrugge, Duisenberg, and the third line is from China to Milano. We will not only provide international transportation solutions, we will also provide local transportation solutions. Once the cargo reached its destinations, we can also arrange for the road transportation, truck transportation. We have our own tow cars or large trucks to support vehicle transportation. By using the new type of trucks, we can considerably reduce the logistic cost for the transportation of vehicles on road. BMW, Volkswagen, and Porsche and Volvo, they have a huge demand for import and export logistics. We're going to start the China to Milan railway pretty soon. And Fiat is very close to Milan also. They need to import a lot of spare parts. And the fourth one is from China to Hamburg. Oh, Willem Heaven, Jaguar Land Rover has a packaging center right there. So we try to cover North Europe, East Europe, West Europe, and South Europe. We work with the Urumqi railway station to set up a rail line connecting China to Iran. Well, we started to collaborate with Audi from 2013. Well, the whole rail train journey will take only 19 to 20 days. This is Volvo Business. It started from 2017. We start from China to Zeebrugge and Ghent. Well, the whole trip takes 23 days. Well, this is the only vehicle designated trains from China to Europe. We dispatch 2 to 3 trips a week. We have our proprietary racket for vehicle transportation. We can carry 25,000 vehicles in round trips per annum. And this is the only train that carries the domestic vehicles or Chinese branded vehicles to European market. And we can use GPS to track the whereabouts of the trains in the whole process. I think this is some of the advantages for Changjiu Logistics Festival. Changjiu Logistics represents a third-party logistics service partner, so we can provide door-to-door solutions. Well, I think this is one of the cutting-edge advantages, the favorite by Volvo. We have a headquarters in Hamburg, and we've been in business for at least more than 4 years. And we have already established a full-fledged systems to provide holistic solution service. And we're also experienced in insurance business. We have 900 sets of high-quality racket, and in addition to that, we also carry out collaborations with the racket manufacturers. We can provide the record service in round trip. It's about returnable packaging. I'll be quick. We got a R&D center and 5 operational centers and provide services to 17 clients. Our total asset value is about 120 million, and we have more than 300,000 returnable package. Audi, Jaguar Land Rover, Volkswagen, and Chery. We designed packages for their spare parts for the above mentioned brands. From planning, design to manufacture, leasing, inventory, cleaning, and end-of-life recycling, we provide holistic solution. Well, this is the returnable packaging for solutions for Audi. We use new materials to replace paper and wood to reduce the consumption of material. We already passed the Audi's inspections and examinations, and we're now in the process of negotiation. Jaguar. Well, this is the record for export for engine export for Jaguar Land Rover. This is also the returnable record. Well, this is the Europe-China returnable packaging operation. This is the returnable packaging's operations for Land Rover. Indeed, we've already established a domestic returnable packaging operation. And we also have established an automotive logistics center in Europe. Zeebrugge is probably the largest vehicle operation center in Western Europe, and we have established a automotive logistics center there. For the past couple of years, Changjiu Logistics has been trying to enter the international market so that we can facilitate the export of Chinese branded vehicles to international market. And I've made my contributions to this process. I'm really happy to have this opportunity to share with you some of my observations. Thank you very much. Well, thank you, Mr. Chen, for your sharing. Changjiu Logistics is doing pretty well in its international business, or the international part of your business. In the near future, we're going to attend a conference in Germany, and if time permits, we'll visit your Automotive for Logistics Center or some of your facilities in Hamburg. Now it's time for question and answers. Our three speakers have given wonderful presentations on import and export, vehicle import and export industry. We don't have much time, so if you have question, please raise your hand. Chairman Ma, I have a question for Mr. Chen. Well, you said you're responsible for the so-called standardized packaging. So I'm quite interested in this kind of the packaging standard, because the packaging standard in China is different from that in Europe. So how do you bridge the gap between the Chinese standards and the European standards? Well, I think you raised a very good question and a high quality question. Well, this is something that puzzles me for a long time. We not only ship vehicles to Europe, but also we're going to do the returnable operations with Japan and even to the United States. And there's a discrepancy between the Chinese standards and international standards. Also, there is a discrepancy between the Japanese standards and the European standards. For Audi, it's the packaging size is 1.1 times 1.4 meters, which is entirely different from the Japanese standard. There's no universal standards applied both in China as well as in overseas markets. Unfortunately, the returnable operations, there is a segregation between domestic returnable operations and international returnable operation. So, what's your recommendations on the unifications of domestic and international standards? Well, I'm very happy to be a part of the standard setting process. I'd love to join in the process to set up a new standards that helps to unify the domestic standards with the standards in Europe, United States, and Japan. But I think it will take a fairly long period of time to reach that final goal. We got a hell lot of work to do. We'd love to help in this process. We can share with you our hands-on experience. Any other questions for our guest speakers? A question over there. Introduce yourself. I'm doing the international business for Changjiu Logistics. I have a question for Mr. Hu. I think there are some catchwords in your presentations. For example, supply side reform and parallel import. One interesting concept you talked about is that in 2015, there is a significant drop in import and export volume in automobile industry. We know that the currency depreciation is has a positive effect on export, and currency appreciation will have a positive effect on import. So do you think that this sudden fluctuations in import and export volume will occur in the future?
非常感谢啊，您刚才这个题目也是我觉得挺大的，因为这里面的影响因素非常多，今天没法展开。Well, there are too many factors. To be brief, I touched upon economic factors and policy issues. Yes, indeed, the currency issues are also quite important. Talking about the reduction, two parts for imports, actually. We didn't tell too much about the figures. For 2015, our figures are about imports. We didn't take the real sales figure as the benchmark. Well, back in year 2013 to 2014, the entire import volume was too high, bringing too many difficulties, and by 2015, the figure, the stock is, there has been an overstocking issue. So the first quarter of 2015 to 2016, or 21 months, being 7 quarters, are destocking a little bit. That's why there has been a reduction of minus 24%. There has been continuous destocking practice. Indeed, last year, almost all the stocks have been cleared away, and ever since Q1 this year, it's getting up a little bit. Last year, this time last year, the rate is minus 3%, but this year onward, the stock volume is within a reasonable range. We cannot say up by too much, but at least it's flat. By 2020, the import market, our forecast is it will continue to slide down. Last year, as I said, 1 million sets, and by 2020, 900,000 sets. That's import. For exports, it's difficult to predict. Favorable actor has been touched upon by Mr. Hu, Belt and Road Initiative. But what on earth will that generate for the export market? It's still unclear. Nobody is working on 2020 forecast. We only have a general direction. It will be positive. But as to how positive, no figures to support. We hope to be a part of the initiative. Thank you. Okay, so before we conclude, any last one? Question for Mr. Chen. You know, our business is developing rapidly, including our international business. So my question is, what is the process of, what is the generic comment on the future development, and what is the core competence of your internationalization? Thank you. 中九 or 长九? I mean packaging. The sub-company is called Zhongshi of Changjiu, and the sub-company of Zhongshi is Zhongjiu. So they have four sectors, I mean the spare parts and the packaging. I myself is the Zhongshi general manager and the Zhongshi chairman. Two and a half years only from the founding of Zhongjiu company. At the time, Chang'an Mazda is our client. We provide full range packaging, including design and investment. This is our first project. In the past, we did some cases for Chery. But after our company was founded, officially we provide services for Mazda. Later, we acquired an order from JLR for all the packaging management. Later, we also extend our footprint into some spare part manufacturers. This year, probably the turnover volume will be around 400 million RMB. We have our core competencies. First of all, we have a strong design team. We have 11 patents. We have an outstanding design capabilities. So in the auto industry, we have standard devices and also non-standard specifications. So for those who are extremely capable at providing non-standard specifications, they will win for pallets, for spare parts, for many other different components of a car. So in the past, due to the issue of non-sharing between different platforms, so we have to work our own way out. So we worked together with the Shanghai GM and tried to acquire more competence through the mutual sharing of expertise and insights, including the framework of a car and also the filling materials and the substances of a car. So we have our own design team. Secondly, we have a strong IT team. This is also our core competence. We have our own IT subsidiary section. They manufacture the RFID labels for us. And also it's light sensitive. Our batteries can sustain for about 5 years. The third core competence is that we have a recyclable platform that we can maneuver. Ever since last October, we start the process of getting listed in Asia. It's less than 3 years, so by August of this year, probably after documents are submitted, there is great likelihood for us to get listed in the Asia market. Thank you. Okay, any questions? Okay. If no questions, I want to ask a question. This year, in China, we have a lot of pure electric cars getting to be exported to overseas markets. There have been a lot of new energy cars in the market now. So I'm wondering whether this is the future direction. We always say that NA, North America, and Europe is our target markets. But for passenger cars and for commercial cars or vehicles, do you think it's another responsibility or opportunity for us to tackle?
Mm-hmm.
in the traditional sector. I think that Europe, America, and Japan represent the area in which we have the most strict regulations and the most fierce competition. The traditional car companies cannot compete with those companies in the short term in those high-end markets. So I think that to go international, especially into this developed market, is a standard by which we gauge your own competence. For the new energy vehicles, or NEVs, indeed, some cars have got successful entry into those markets, but the market size is not so big. Thanks to the policy boost and the support of the Chinese government, the production volume of new energy vehicles is about 510,000 cars, number one in the world. The electrification rate for all the passenger cars for NEVs is over 20% in the market. In the passenger cars, some companies are looking for opportunities to compete with others. Indeed, I think that those locally manufactured pure electric vehicles have their own competitive advantage, relatively speaking, in other developed markets, including North America and Europe. So we have the confidence to be on the same level and to compete with other big powers like Jinglong or Yutong. Electric powered passenger cars can be a future point of breakthrough, but for small passenger sedan cars, probably we still have a long way to go. Thank you. Okay, due to the time limit, we finished the online discussions, so you can leave more questions offline during the tea breaks, as you like. So I want to thank all the three panelists, including Mr. Hu, Mr. Chen, for their wonderful presentation. So after the tea break, let's start the second session. We will invite Mr. Zhang Xiaodong from Beijing Jiaotong University to be the moderator. Thank you.